him. He's worthy to be praised. Thank you, Heavenly Father. In Jesus' precious name. We're going to pray a prayer before we take our seat. In Isaiah chapter 43, verse 16, and then we read verse 19 thereafter. Isaiah chapter 43, verse 16, and then we read also verse 19. Hear what the word of God says. In Isaiah chapter 43 and verse 16, thus saith the Lord, which maketh a way in the sea and a path in the mighty waters. People of God, it was a highway that God made for his people in the twinkling of an eye. For those that are in the construction industry, you know that it is an impossible task to create a highway, not just a way, a highway for 3 million people, just like that. And God made the water on either side of the highway to be a retaining wall for the children of Israel. You know what it takes to build a retaining wall? It takes a lot of concrete. The mixture of the concrete for retaining wall is not the same with ordinary wall. God made the waters on either side of the highway to be a retaining wall for 3 million people to pass. God specializes in making a way where there seems to be no way. In verse 19 of Isaiah chapter 43, the Bible said in verse 19, behold, I will do a new thing. Now, not later, now shall it spring forth. Shall you not know it? I will even make a way in the wilderness and rivers in the desert. I will make a way in the wilderness. The wilderness situation of life connotes a time and season of difficulties and adversity. But in that seemingly difficult situation of your life, that seemingly impossible situation, God is saying this morning that he will make a way for you. I'd like you to pray. Father, make a way for me this week. Zota ragabalaya. Make a way for me this week. Make a way for me like you did for the children of Israel in the Red Sea. Make a way for me this week. Like you did for the children of Israel in the Red Sea. Make a way for me. Thank you, Heavenly Father. Blessed be your name forever. In Jesus' precious name. Heavenly Father, we are standing here today only because you made a way. Our eyes are upon you and upon you alone. For they looked up to you and their faces were lightened and they were not ashamed. This morning as we look up to you, cause our faces to be lightened. Let whatever constitutes shame and reproach be rolled away from our lives. Cause the light of your countenance to shine upon everyone under the sound of my voice. Father, this morning, I submit myself totally and unreservedly unto you. Lord, let it be all of you and none of me at all. Ingrace me to speak as your oracle for the miracles of your people. Let your word find free course and be glorified in everyone's life by many infallible proofs. My Father, give testimony to the word of your grace. And above all, let your name and your name alone be glorified in Jesus' precious name. Give Jesus a big, big clap offering of praise. Please be seated in God's presence. My case is different because I am a redeemer of the Lord. And as a covenant child, what affects others is not permitted to affect me. Congratulations. With Jesus' joy in your heart and with a smile on your face, welcome your neighbor seated beside you on the left and on the right. Prophesy into your neighbor's life. Tell your neighbor you are blessed and highly favored. To another neighbor, you are blessed and highly favored. Now prophesy to yourself, I am blessed and I am highly favored. So shall it be for you in Jesus' precious name. As we progress in this service, let me show you what we'll be looking at in our prayer meeting tomorrow in 1 hour with Jesus. The year 2017 has been prophetically declared by the apostle and prophet over this commission in the person of Dr. David Odupo as our year of my case is different. It is a year that we are destined, ordained to experience endless testimonies and noiseless breakthroughs. But it is important to understand that noiseless breakthroughs cannot be achieved until the barriers blocking breakthroughs are broken. There are barriers to noiseless breakthroughs that must be broken for your breakthrough to be secured. In Psalms 107, verses 15 and 16, Psalms 107, verse 15 to 16, oh, that man will praise the Lord for his goodness and for his wonderful works to the children of men. This year, you will praise God for his goodness and his wonderful works in your life. In the precious name of Jesus Christ. The wonderful works of God, when they happen in rapid succession, we call them wonders without number. They are also known as endless testimonies. But for that to happen, see what must take place in the next verse. For he had broken the gates of brass and cut the barriers of iron in sunder. So barriers to breakthroughs must be broken in order for you to secure your noiseless breakthroughs. Therefore, in our prayer meeting tomorrow, we'll be sharing the topic, breaking breakthrough barriers. Breaking breakthrough barriers. In 2017, no satanic barrier will stop you from obtaining your noiseless breakthroughs. It is not a prayer service to miss. Please don't miss it for anything. You can also invite friends and loved ones to be part of it in Jesus' precious name. Now, for all our eligible singles, this year shall be your year of marital settlement. All our eligible singles in this church that desire to be married, this year shall be your year of marital settlement. Every spell or enchantment responsible for marital delay or impossibility in your life shall be destroyed. In Isaiah chapter 14 and verse 31, Isaiah chapter 14 and verse 31, the word of God says, howl, O gate, cry, O city, thou whole Palestina, art dissolved. For there shall come forth from the north a smoke, and none shall be alone in his appointed times. None shall be alone in his appointed time. And this year is your appointed time to be maritally settled. This year, by the mystery of divine connection, you shall be joined to the bone of your bones. Genesis chapter 2, verse 22 to verse 23. By the mystery of divine connection, you shall be joined to the bone of your bones. And the rib which the Lord had taken from man made he a woman and brought her unto the man. Verse 23, and Adam said, this is now bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh, and she shall be called woman because she was taken out of man. You will be divinely connected to the bone of your bones this year. How will that happen? In Ezekiel 37 and verse 7, See how it will happen. And that is what we'll be doing in the third service. So I prophesy as I was commanded. And as I prophesied, there was a noise, and behold, a shaking. And the bones came together, bone to his bones. No mistake. You will not marry wrongly. The bones came together, bone to his bone. As I prophetically declare God's word over your life, you shall be divinely connected to the bone of your bones. And so in the third service, for all our eligible singles that desire to be married this year, I'll be declaring God's prophetic word over your life for your marital settlement. Don't miss it. Except if you don't want to be married this year. Praise God. I'll be inviting you to the altar and be prophetically declaring your marital settlement. Every devil responsible for delaying your marital destiny must give way this time. In the precious name of Jesus Christ. Our teaching series for all our Sunday services this month has been captioned, "What Wisdom Is This?" Let me begin by saying that the supremacy and superiority of divine wisdom over the wisdom of this world, which is also known as intellectual wisdom, and satanic wisdom, which is also known as occultic wisdom, cannot be contested. This is because the wisdom of God is from above, and that which is from above is above that which is not from above. In 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 6 to verse 9, that's our anchor scripture. 1 Corinthians chapter 2 from verse 2, we read to verse 8 for the purpose of time. "Howbeit we speak wisdom among them that are perfect, yet not the wisdom of this world, nor of the princes of this world that come to naught. But we speak the wisdom of God in a mystery, even the hidden wisdom which God ordained before the world unto our glory, which none of the princes of this world knew. For had they known it," or had they known the wisdom of God, "they would not have crucified the Lord of glory." The wisdom of God is beyond their level of comprehension. The wisdom of God is from above, and that which is from above is above that which is not from above. In John chapter 3 and verse 31, the Bible said, "That which is from above is above all." That which is from above is above all. The wisdom of God from above is to enable believers to operate above principalities, powers of darkness, and all that corrupts in this world. Please listen. The wisdom of God, the essence of the wisdom of God from above, is to enable believers to operate above principalities and powers and all that corrupts in this world. Therefore, as you operate the wisdom of God this season, you shall not be corrupted by what corrupts the people of this world. In the precious name of Jesus Christ. The Bible said in Ephesians chapter 1 from verse 17 to verse 21, Ephesians chapter 1 from verse 17 to verse 21, that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give unto you the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of him. The spirit of wisdom and revelation. For what purpose will this spirit of wisdom and revelation be given unto you? Now let's find out as we read on. "That the eyes of your understanding being enlightened, that ye may know what is the hope of his calling, and what the riches of the glory of his inheritance in the saints is, and what is the exceeding greatness of his power to us ward who believe, according to the working of his mighty power, which he wrought in Christ when he raised him from the dead and set him at his own right hand in the heavenly places." Where? In the heavenly places. And see how far these heavenly places is to the realm of principalities and powers. Look at it. Far above all principality and power and might and dominion and every name that is named, not only in this world, but also in that which is to come. So the essence of the impartation of the spirit of wisdom from above is to enable believers to operate above all principalities and powers of darkness and all that corrupts in this world. We operate above them. Is somebody hearing what I'm saying, sir? This wisdom is from above. And because it is from above, it is above all that is not from above. In James chapter 3, verse 13 to verse 18, let's look at the characteristics or the attributes of divine wisdom from above. James chapter 3 from verse 13. Who is a wise man endued with knowledge among you? Let him show out of a good conversation his works with meekness of wisdom. Meekness of wisdom. So one of the attributes of the wisdom of God from above is meekness. Please listen. God's wisdom makes men meek, not proud. God's wisdom makes men meek, not proud. The Bible talks about the meekness of wisdom. In Proverbs chapter 11 and verse 2, Proverbs chapter 11 and verse 2, the word of God says, when pride cometh, then cometh shame. But with the lowly, with the humble, or with the meek, is wisdom. That means the wisdom of God cannot produce in a proud life. God's wisdom cannot produce in a life that is proud. What is pride? A proud man is a man with an exaggerated opinion of himself than who he truly is. A proud man is a man with an exaggerated opinion of himself than who he truly is. In Romans chapter 12 and verse 3, Romans chapter 12 and verse 3, for I say unto you through the grace given unto me, to every man that is among you, not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think, but to think soberly, according as God had dealt to every man the measure of faith. Pride is having an exaggerated opinion of oneself. It is thinking of oneself more highly than where God has placed him. A proud man is one that thinks of himself more highly than where God has placed him. And as such, he begins to exercise himself in matters that are higher than his level. In Psalms 131, verse 1 to verse 2, Psalms 131 from verse 1 to verse 2, the psalmist speaking here said, Lord, my heart is not haughty, nor my eyes lofty. Neither do I exercise myself in great matters or in things too high for me. Please understand that men are in sizes. Life is in phases. It is wisdom to operate at your level. Don't exercise yourself in matters higher than your level. That is pride. See what the psalmist said in verse 2 of that Psalms 131. He says, surely I have behaved myself and quieted myself as a child that is weaned out of his mother's breast. My soul is even as a weaned child. So it is maturity to know where God has placed you and remain there. It is maturity to know your level and remain at your level. Don't exercise yourself in matters higher than your level. And we all have our respective individual levels. We all have our different levels. We are not all the same. Know your level and remain there. Operate at your level. And when you outgrow your present level, God will move you to your next level. Are you following what I'm saying? Pride is having an exaggerated opinion of oneself. A proud man is one who looks down on others because of his position or possession. He is a man who thinks highly of his reputation instead of thinking of making contribution to better other lives. A proud man is one who thinks highly of his reputation instead of the contributions that he will make to better other lives. The scripture admonishes us to have the mind of Christ, who made himself of no reputation in order to live a life of contribution to humanity. Philippians chapter 2, verse 5 to verse 8. The Bible said, "Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who though he was God, thought it not robbery to equal himself with God." So it wouldn't have been a sin or robbery for Jesus to equal himself with God. That's what that verse is talking about. It wouldn't have been an offense or a sin or robbery for Jesus to equal himself with God. The Bible says, who being God, thought it not robbery to equal himself with God. It wouldn't have been an offense if he did. But see what he did instead. But he made himself of no reputation. He made himself of no reputation and took upon him the form of a servant and was made in the likeness of man. And being found in fashion as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. That is the kind of mentality that the scripture admonishes us to have. The mind of Christ, who made himself of no reputation in order to live a life of contribution to better humanity. Please listen. Nothing corrupts wisdom like pride. In Ezekiel chapter 28, verse 15 to verse 17. Ezekiel 28 from verse 15 to verse 17. The Bible said, "Thou was perfect in thy ways from the day that thou was created." He was created perfect. Talking about Lucifer here. "Thou was perfect in thy ways in the day that thou was created, till iniquity was found in thee." What was the iniquity? Let's find out. He said, "By the multitude of thy merchandise, they have filled the midst of thee with violence. Thou hast sinned. Therefore, I will cast thee as profane out of the mountain of God. And I will destroy thee, O covering cherub, from the midst of the stones of fire." Verse 17, see his problem. "Thine heart was lifted up because of thy beauty. And as a result, thou hast corrupted thy wisdom." Nothing corrupts wisdom like pride. I want you to understand that. It was pride that made Lucifer to lose his place in heaven forever. Forever. Please hear this. God will always resist the proud, but he will always assist the humble. James chapter 4 verse 6. God will always resist the proud, but he will always assist the humble. The Bible said, "But he giveth more grace. Wherefore he said, God resisted the proud, but giveth grace unto the humble." Please understand this today, that men of reputation who use their position or possession to reproach or oppress God's people end up suffering desolation without remedy. In Zephaniah chapter 2, verse 9 and verse 10, the Bible said, "Therefore, as I live, saith the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, surely Moab shall be as Sodom." Wipe out. God wiped out Sodom. There's no trace of it. "And the children of Ammon as Gomorrah. Even the breeding of nettles and salt pits. And a perpetual desolation. The residue of my people shall spoil them. The remnant of my people shall possess them." Why? This shall they have for their what? For their pride. Because they have reproached and magnified themselves against the people of the Lord. Those who use their position and possession to reproach or oppress God's people, they end up suffering desolation without remedy. So as you serve God's people in whatsoever capacity, please serve them in such a way that it will be pleasing to God for your blessing, not in a way that will be detrimental to your life and destiny. As you serve God in whatsoever capacity, as you attend to God's people in whatever capacity, serve in such a way that it will be pleasing to God for your blessing, not in a way that it will be detrimental to your life and destiny. Is somebody hearing what I'm saying, sir? Especially for those of us who serve in a church like this, where God is mighty in the midst of his people. Let us serve in such a way that it will be pleasing to God for our blessing, not in a way that it will be detrimental to our lives and destinies. We have an example in scripture of a man who was not careful in the way he addressed God's people. As a result, he paid dearly for it. In Psalms 106, verse 32 to verse 33, Psalms 106, verse 32 to verse 33, the Bible said, they angered him, talking about Moses, they angered him also at the waters of strife, so that it went ill with Moses for their sake. Look at it. Because they provoked his spirit, so that he did what? He spake unadvisedly with his lips. They provoked him to the extent that he opened his mouth and spoke unadvisedly with his lips against God's people. And you know, as we serve in the vineyard of the Lord, there are people that will provoke you, sir. Some people will step on your toes, either deliberately or mistakenly. It doesn't really matter. Refuse to be provoked. That singular action, the Bible says it went ill with Moses for their sake. That singular action cost him entering Canaan land physically. Even when he prayed and cried and besought the Lord for God to permit him to enter, God said to him, if it is on this matter, I will not hear you. Deuteronomy chapter 3, verse 23 to verse 26. Look at it. Deuteronomy chapter 3, verse 23 to verse 26. Watch this. Moses speaking here. He said, I besought the Lord at that time, saying, O Lord, thou hast begun to show thy servant thy greatness and thy mighty hand. For what God is there in heaven or in earth that can do according to thy works and according to thy might? I pray thee, let me go over and see the good land that is beyond Jordan, that goodly mountain and Lebanon. I pray thee, let me go over. But the Lord was wroth with me for your sakes, and will not hear me. And the Lord said unto me, let it suffice thee. Speak no more unto me on this matter. You will not miss your Canaan land. I've made up my mind that another person's misbehavior will not cost me eternity. Please, as we serve God in this church, in whatever capacity, let us serve him in such a way that it will be pleasing to him for our blessing, not in a way that will be detrimental to our lives and destinies. God is jealous over his people. It doesn't matter their level. Do you know, sir, that God never asked Moses what the people did to him? Never. God never asked Moses what the people did to him to provoke him to the extent of speaking unadvisedly with his lips against them. God said to him, because you provoked me at the waters of Meribah. You spoke against my people. What did he say? You stiff-necked people. Against God's people. Are people made in the image and his likeness? Be careful. No matter how somebody provokes you, maintain yourself, sir. Serve with joy and gladness, irrespective of how people treat you. Don't be a stumbling block to somebody's eternity. Is somebody hearing what I'm saying? The wisdom of God makes people meek, not proud. How do we access the wisdom of God? In 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 15, let's see how to access the wisdom of God. And then we close. And from a child, thou hast known the holy scriptures, which are able to make thee wise unto salvation through faith, which is in Christ Jesus. Listen, God's word makes men wise. From a child, thou hast known the holy scriptures, which are able to make you wise. So wisdom comes by a tireless commitment to the study of God's word. Because God's word is God's wisdom and God's thoughts in print. Please hear this again. God's word is God's wisdom and God's thoughts in print. So constant study of the word imparts God's wisdom and God's thoughts to your thoughts. And his thoughts are higher than the thoughts of men. Isaiah chapter 55 verses 8 and 9. His thoughts are higher than the thoughts of men. See what the Bible said in Isaiah chapter 55 verses 8 and 9. For my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways, said the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. Is somebody seeing that, sir? By constant study of God's word, you are imbibing God's wisdom and God's thoughts to your thoughts. And when his thoughts dominate your thoughts, you begin to think like him over the issues of life. And then you begin to see things the way he sees them. And you begin to behave the way God behaves. And then you begin to act like God and become like God. Because you will always be what you think. The Bible said in Proverbs 23 verse 7. As he thinketh in his heart, so is he. As he thinketh in his heart, so you see, you become exactly what you think. Your life will always move in the direction of your most dominant thoughts. So when God's thoughts dominate your thoughts, you begin to think the way God thinks over the issues of life, and then you begin to see things the way God sees them. You begin to behave the way God behaves until you become like God. And when you become like God and begin to operate like God, you have dominion over the issues of life. Because the essence of operating like God is to have dominion. In Genesis 1, 26 and 27, hear what the Bible said. In Genesis 1, 26, and God said, let us make man, how? In our image, after our likeness. Let us make man to look like us. For what reason? And let them have dominion. So you are redeemed to dominate and not to be dominated. Is somebody hearing me, sir? God made man like him so that man can have dominion. But the first Adam lost that nature of God, and as a result, he lost dominion over the issues of life. Before the first Adam lost the nature of God and dominion over the issues of life, he single-handedly named every animal, including animals in the sea and in the sky. That's a mystery. How did he do it? He had to enter the sea to name the animals on the sea because he had to inspect them to name them. How did he name the animals on air? When we get to heaven, we'll find out from Adam. He must have gotten up there. That was the nature of dominion that he had. Is somebody here? What I'm saying? He entered the water and stayed there with all the animals in water. And they said, some scientists said that the animals inside the sea are more than the animals on land. I don't know how true. I'm not a scientist. I'm just a preacher of the word of God. But Adam must have been there in the water and he didn't die. That's dominion over dead. Is somebody hearing what I'm saying, sir? But he lost that nature of God and dominion. But the good news is this. What was lost to man in the first Adam was restored back to man in the second Adam. Jesus Christ is the second Adam. So there's the restoration of divine nature which conferred on us dominion over the issues of life. Is somebody hearing what I'm saying? Let me round up by saying, let's look at one or two examples of men that operated like God and exercised dominion in life. Let's look at the example of Paul the Apostle, and then we close from there. In Acts of the Apostles chapter 14, we read verse 8 to verse 11. Acts chapter 14, from verse 8 to verse 11, the Bible says, there sat a certain man at Lystra, impotent in his feet, being a cripple from his mother's womb, who never had walked. This man had never walked in his life. He was a cripple from his mother's womb and was born a cripple. He had never walked in his life. Now look at the next verse. The Bible said, the same man heard Paul speak, who steadfastly beholding Paul and perceiving that he had faith to be healed, the Bible said, Paul said unto him with a loud voice, stand upright on thy feet. And he leaped and walked. The man that has never walked. Everyone that has ever walked on this earth, learn how to walk. And in the process of learning how to walk, you fall several times. This man who had never walked started walking without falling. Even people who had walked before, but as a result of accident or something, could not walk again. They have to be trained in the process of walking again. That's those who had walked before. But this man who had never walked, as a result of an encounter with God and the power of God, stood up and started walking perfectly. That on its own is a miracle. And then when the people saw what Paul had done, the next verse, when the people saw what Paul had done, they lifted up their voices, saying in the speech of Lyconia, the gods are come down to us in the likeness of man. Paul operated as a god by operating in the supernatural, in the realm of miracles, signs, and wonders. And the Bible said concerning you and I and the children that the Lord has given unto me, we are for signs and for wonders. Isaiah 8:18. On another occasion, in Acts of the Apostles, chapter 28, verse 1 to verse 6, Acts 28 from verse 1 to verse 6, the Bible said, and when they were escaped, then they knew that the island was called Melita. Verse 2, and the barbarous people shew us no little kindness, for they kindled a fire and received us, everyone, because of the present rain and because of the cold. And when Paul had gathered a bundle of sticks and laid them on the fire, there came out a viper out of the heat. The fire was too much for the viper. The viper came out when the fire was too much. The viper was hiding amongst the sticks all this while, rotting havoc amongst the people. Just as there are devils hiding in people's life, machinating wickedness against them. And the reason why they are comfortable in their hiding place is because the fire is not enough. When you generate enough fire, every devil hiding in any corner of your life, doing evil to your life, will come out. That devil will be exposed. Fire will expose the devil. Is somebody hearing what I'm saying? When the fire was too much, the viper came out and fastened on Paul's hands. And when the barbarians saw the venomous beast hang on his hand, They said among themselves, no doubt this man is a murderer. They concluded. They formed an opinion. And everybody is free to form their opinion about you. But their opinion does not have to be your reality. They form an opinion about Paul. And they said, this man is a murderer, whom though he had escaped the sea, yet vengeance suffereth not to leave. But the Bible said he shook off the beast into the fire and felt no harm. Behold, I give unto you power to tread upon serpents and scorpions and over every power of the enemy, and nothing shall by any means hurt you. Luke 10:19. The Bible said, when the people waited for a long while to see whether Paul would swell up and fall and die as a result of the venom of the viper that had beaten him, and when they saw that he did not fall down and die, they changed their minds and said that what? He was a god. People will change their minds about you, sir. Those that are waiting for you to fail or to fall, they shall wait in vain. Because instead of failure, they will see your success. Success that is beyond ordinary human beings to accomplish. Success that only gods can accomplish will be your portion this season. Stand on your feet with me. I'd like you to stretch your hand towards the altar. Father, I decree and I declare the release of heaven's order of signs and wonders and testimonies in everyone's life this week, in the name of Jesus. This is our encounter with destiny service. And every encounter with God leaves the encounter with testimonies to count. Therefore, I decree that throughout this week, you will have testimonies to count by reason of your encounter with God today. In the name of Jesus, the week is declared your week of endless testimonies, of noiseless breakthroughs, of heaven's order of signs and wonders. Results beyond human imagination will be your portion throughout this week. So shall it be. Before we close, if you are here under the sound of my voice, listen very carefully. God brought you here to connect with your life so that you can connect from him. Because you see, sir, until you connect with God, you cannot collect from God. Until you connect with God, you cannot collect from God. Your life as it is right now can never be better than what it is until somebody better than you enters your life, and there's nobody better than Jesus. Life without Christ continues in crisis. God saw you struggling on your own, all alone, to make things happen, to make ends meet. Yet the more you struggle to make things happen, the more nothing happens. The more you struggle to make ends meet, the more the ends stay apart. And God saw you in your struggling state and he said, come unto me, all ye that labor with nothing to show, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, I will give you rest. And when God gives you rest, no devil can give you distress. As all heads are bowed and all eyes closed, you are tired of living life from one crisis to another. You want to say to Christ, take over, let the crisis be over. I will pray for you. You want God to connect with your life so you can collect from God. I will pray for you. You want God to change your life and the story of your life from a story of sorry to a story of glory. I will pray for you. As all heads are bowed right now and all eyes closed, you want to say yes to Jesus Christ. Lift up your right hand right now, right there where you are standing, to Jesus, the one that can change your life, the one that can change the story of your life, the one that can give you a new beginning. Thank you for this hand this way. Thank you for that other hand. Thank you for that hand on the back. Thank you for this hand. If you are lifting up your hand, lift it high above your head. You are not lifting that hand to any man. You are lifting that hand to the Almighty God. The only one that can change your life. The only one that can change the story of your life. The only one that can give you a beginning. I want God to use that hand that you have lifted up to lift you up. So if you are lifting up your hand, lift it high above your head. Thank you for all those hands at the gallery. Thank you for those hands. Thank you for that hand at the gallery this way. As all heads remain bowed and all eyes remain closed, you have lifted up your hand to Jesus. Please come right now to the altar. Don't be the last person to come to the altar. Be the first to come to Jesus. Come with speed. Come just as you are. He will take you just as you are. Make something wonderful out of your life. Change your life and the story of your life. You are not responding to the call of a man. You are responding to the call of Jesus, the Messiah, the way maker, the miracle worker. He is here to change your life and the story of your life. Church, give Jesus a big, big clap offering of praise. As they come, they are coming in their droves. The power of God for salvation is moving in this house right now. Celebrate Jesus with a big, big clap offering of praise. Choir, sing as they come. Please get seated. Everyone in the front and those that are still coming, welcome to Jesus. Welcome. Welcome. My invitee is here. My invitee is here. Many of them. Welcome. Now, everyone, place your right hand on your chest like this. Say this prayer after me. Say, Lord Jesus, I open my heart to you. Come into my heart. Take your place in my life. Forgive me all my sins. Wash me today with your precious blood and write my name in the book of life. From today, I will follow you and I will serve you all the days of my life. So help me God. It is done. By your decision and prayer of salvation, you are established in the kingdom of God as a child of God. Begin to experience the blessings of God. In Jesus' name. Now open your eyes, all of you. You see our pastor this way beside the choir? Please follow him right now for some very, very important information. Celebrate Jesus some more. Give him a big, big clap offering of praise.